Penguin Random House Audio presents Unladylike, a field guide to smashing the patriarchy and claiming your space. Written and read by
Cristen Conger
and Caroline Ervin.
This audiobook includes a PDF with creative infographics from the book that we'll be referring to throughout the program, and you can view them on your computer or download and print them for viewing anytime.
Introduction. Patriarchy says behave.
Unladylike, adjective. 1. Behaving in a manner that figuratively and or literally flips off patriarchal subordination, silencing, and sexual double standards. 2. Foregoing discriminatory privileges while pursuing compassionate, thriving, self-defined lives. 3. Patriarchy's go-to gender citation for doing womanhood wrong. Patriarchy, noun. Men on top social hierarchy characterized by fragile masculinity, imposed maternity, and male sexual entitlement. Smash the patriarchy, verb. To flex unladylike persistence for the resistance.
Ladyhood was a real bitch in her heyday. 2 centuries ago, white ladies-only public spaces abounded to protect them from rubbing elbows with working-class women and other deplorables. There were ladies' horses, lounges, boat cabins, railway cars, colleges, and courtroom galleries. They even had their own dessert, lady cakes, made with rose water and a dash of entitlement. Oh, girl. Respect for woman, the much-lauded chivalry of the Middle Ages, meant what I fear it still means. That supercilious caste spirit in America which cynically assumes a Negro woman cannot be a lady, Anna Julia Cooper wrote in her groundbreaking 1892 essay collection, A Voice from the South. Born to a black mother and a white slave owner, Cooper was among the vanguard of black feminist organizing of the time, which W.E.B. Du Bois described as at once both the lever and the fulcrum for uplifting the race. The racist reality of whites-only ladyhood also galvanized activist Ida B. Wells to pursue journalism full-time, wielding the power of the pen and her voice to publicize the brutalities of lynchings and sexual violence perpetrated against African Americans in the Jim Crow South. In 1883, Wells had seated herself in a ladies' train car since there wasn't a designated blacks-only car. But when the conductor noticed her, he attempted to physically remove her. Wells later recounted in her autobiography,
"The moment he caught hold of my arm, I fastened my teeth in the back of his hand. I had braced my feet against the seat in front and was holding to the back. And as he had already been badly bitten, he didn't try it again by himself. He went forward and got the baggage man and another man to help him. And of course, they succeeded in dragging me out."
Afterward, Wells sued the railroad company and won. But when the railroad appealed the decision, the Tennessee Supreme Court overturned the previous ruling on account of Wells's unladylike persistence. She lived up to the judge's verdict, too, agitating against murderous white supremacy and traveling around the U.S., organizing black women into clubs that could band together to create community and support networks.
Patriarchy's dream girls. By the 1900s, the Industrial Revolution, capitalism, and urbanism had remodeled the home as husbands' moral refuge from the sinful world, where they nobly toiled to provide for wives and children and pay for occasional brothel visits. Whatever disappointments or venereal diseases befell them, men could return home to a place where they always knew best. Ladies got a new middle-class role model to match, a feminine foil to masculine lust. Idolized in popular lady mags like Godey's Ladies' Book, the true woman was expected to want for nothing more than to please and be pleasant, embodying the top 4 most desirable traits that turned ordinary gals into wife material. 1. Piety. Assigning faith to the fairer sex offered ladies safe intellectual exercise through reading the Bible and gave them another male figure to obey when the man of the house was away. Religion is exactly what a woman needs, the Ladies' Repository magazine advised readers circa 1860, for it gives her that dignity that best suits her dependence.
Number 2, purity. Listen up, ladies. Sex with anyone but husbands and desirous of anything beyond pleasing him and making babies is a one-way ticket to despair, destitution, insanity, and possibly death. So, masturbation? Nope. Keep your hands where we can see them.
Number 3, submissiveness. Y'all know that tired sitcom trope of the level-headed wife who bites her tongue while her dopey husband does something foolish again? That characterization reads like a modern update on Victorian true womanhood, which urged women to submit to their husbands and always let him think he's right.
Number 4, domesticity. What more could a true woman ask for than a loving-ish husband and home fires to tend? Children, duh. Being a wife is all right, but the fullest expression of womanhood is motherhood.
But as the 20th century crept closer, headstrong gals were losing interest in patriarchy's pre-written gender scripts. Suffragist and women's historian Matilda Jocelyn Gage was one such rebel, and in 1893, she published Woman, Church, and State, which essentially predicted modern feminism. The system of oppression she called the patriarchate was a result of organized religion, Christianity specifically, and government working together against women, and it was evident in everything from witch hunts to rape to the denial of property rights and the vote. Together, church and state upheld a misogynistic system, blaming women for sin and using Eve's curse as an excuse to hold all women down and eventually tax tampons as luxury goods. Women's libbers wanted ladyhood to burn like bras. On March 18, 1970, dozens of feminists marched to the Manhattan office of the Ladies' Home Journal and demanded the male editor-in-chief resign and promote the female managing editor in his place. The sit-in was largely a publicity stunt to draw attention to how lady mags reduced women to their beauty insecurities, shopping habits, and housewifery. The magazine made the promotion 3 years later. Even as the gender revolution cooled in the 1980s and 90s, academics and media outlets deemed lady an outdated honorific, until millennial gals later adopted her as slang. But so long as patriarchy exists, that L-word has staying power. Look no further than aspirational lifestyles of so-called effortless, upscale femininity. As her favored figure, fashions, and baked goods have evolved for better Instagram angles, ladyhood has also lived on through 21st century pastimes like slut-shaming, skin-lightening, body-hating, wage-skimping, waist-nipping, racial profiling, victim-blaming, poverty-moralizing, motherhood-penalizing, non-motherhood double-penalizing, sex-stigmatizing, and gender-policing. In other words, ladies may seem gone, but they are far from forgotten. Constructed from classism, anchored in white supremacy, and reinforced by rape culture, ladyhood was built to last.
Get unladylike. Regardless of who we are, what we look like, and how many advantages life has dropped in our laps, none of us is immune to patriarchy's ladylike claptrap. Guys get entitlement, gals get objectified, and non-binary folks get dehumanized and worse. Like a broken record, women are still incentivized to be sexy, but not slutty, beauty conscious, but not vain, motherly, but not smothering, and presidential, but not mannish. If we don't care to dare those tightropes, how selfish, so shrill, just sad. Regardless of whether men are literally in charge, we all can internalize sexist preferences and put downs like a contact high or low. Once you spot sexist species, summon patience. It might take more time, headspace, and digging to figure out where it came from and why it won't just die already. And that's why this guide exists. The only women patriarchy fears more than unladylike women are persistent unladylike women. We're flies in the ointment, harpies at the frat house, and pussies grabbing back. Likeability, attractiveness, and class aren't our currencies, but we're far from bankrupt. So long as we're gutsy enough to get loud, loose, and livid, unladylike witches do what it takes to smash the patriarchy that stands in our way. At its core, this is a field guide to the patriarchal creepy crawlies that stand between you and the autonomous, safe, compassionate person you were put on this planet to be. To be clear, this isn't about magical makeovers, though we do love a good makeover montage. Our unladylike feminism in action applies to all major facets of our lives. Brains, bodies, besties, wardrobes, work goals, wife roles, hookups, and fuck-ups. No space is exempt or topic taboo.
We'll reveal modern patriarchy's many disguises and what to do when its influencing, privileging, and profiteering slithers into your home, school, work, and even your mirror. You'll pick up some practical feminist life hacks, as well as tips for detoxing from the sexist myths, mindsets, and stereotypes culture constantly force-feeds us. Exactly what that means will be different for everyone. Maybe you'll smash a stiletto through glass ceilings, cure Silicon Valley sexism, or volunteer for a rape crisis hotline. Who knows? By the time we've arrived on the last page, we'll have...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.